thumb on the scale. Now, this is great, however, for the short sellers, because anything that depresses the share, the value of the share of stock, helps that. Starting with the basics, short selling, as most of you, I'm sure, are aware, is when you make an investment that actually pays off if the targeted investment, the security that you're getting involved with, goes down. And the gentleman who's at, you know, one of the prominent people involved in this is Steve Eisman. He became a billionaire by shorting securities that were based on mortgage loans right before the whole mortgage blow-up. So he's a very shrewd guy. He knows how to play short. He knows what to do. And he's quoted as saying, "I never thought I'd be able to short a whole industry again. But boy, this is, you know, this is his happy day." Senator Harkin, who chairs the committee, the health committee, health, education, labor, and pensions, called on him because he had heard that he had been going over to education, consulting with them, and so forth, and giving speeches. Called on him to testify. He came before the Senate, before the committee, gave a lengthy speech where he just ripped into for-profit education. He publicly recommended regulations, stiff regulations. Of course, his idea of regulations is it ought to focus not necessarily on other groups of students who may be somewhat disadvantaged trying to get a career education, like Pell students at school universities, like community college students. He wanted something that ripped the bottom out of the schools which were for-profit and which were listed on the stock exchange. As I say, he had no background in education, but he certainly knew how to short a stock. So he was brought in. What followed next quickly was Senator Harkin called for, and emails later came out, pressured GAO to do a study. The study was one of these secret shopper studies, where they had people portraying possible students go to various for-profit reps, or what were represented to be, and they came out and published a study. This was summer of last year that said, well, there were 28 findings, and it was biased as all get out against the proprietary schools. But it seemed fishy, and a number of folks started questioning. Congressman Issa over at the House asked for backup tapes, others asked for backup tapes. This stuff started coming out, and what do you know? There was bias galore. Statements were twisted around to mean the exact opposite. You had findings that were not based on the tapes. You had all kinds of things. What happened then was the GAO, under all this criticism, I believe it was the day before the Thanksgiving weekend, announced that there were some corrections. Turned out 16 out of 28 findings either had to be eliminated or changed dramatically. Anybody who's in Washington any length of time knows that bad news gets announced on a Friday afternoon because people won't read the paper on Saturday. And really bad, really embarrassing news goes out before a three-day holiday. So the Thanksgiving stunt was the GAO's way of saying, we really messed up, but we don't want you reading about it. And they did replace the person who headed up the unit that did this study. So that kind of speaks for itself. But here's what the damage was. The damage on the GAO study, following it, the market dropped. These were the stocks of the for-profit corporations. Dropped 14%. They lost $4.4 billion in value. And a study that took place a little after that showed, this was, would have been 5 months after the June 24th hearing, showed that the stocks of 13 education corporations dropped $7.9 billion, and that's 29%. That's real money. We don't know because there's no report requirement that the public has access to show how much Mr. Eisman and his cohorts in the short selling community made by this. But they made a lot of money, and they destroyed a lot of shareholder wealth. And the tie-in between them and the Department of Education was hand in glove. Let me just very briefly walk through that. We have found out, thanks to these, not just email requests, but litigation. The Department of Education was sued because they were dragging their feet. They didn't want, for some reason, the public to see what the emails were between the short sellers and the people in the Department of Education. They lost in federal court. FOIAs are the preferred type of litigation. You can get a faster hearing in federal court, especially in D.C., where most FOIA cases are handled. And what do you know? You have Eisman sending an email to one of the top education officials right before the preliminary rate came out, saying, "I know you can't respond to this." That's in the title line. And underneath he said, "Oh, people are getting the idea that you're going to weaken one of the regulation. It won't be as strong." And the education stocks are starting to run, which I presume is Wall Street jargon for they're actually going back up again. We can't have this. And so that was one of the emails. There were plenty of others. People at the Department of Education knew that the short sellers were working on it because not only were they coming by to their office sending them emails, but they were being asked by the Department of Education to come up with negative anecdotes, for example. Not positive anecdotes, not anecdotes pro and con, but give us every horror story you can imagine. Now, the regulatory process is not supposed to be this way. Under the Administrative Procedures Act 1946, it's supposed to be fair, it's supposed to be open, it's supposed to be balanced. And when you have situations where you don't have that, then, you know, first of all, you're undermining the integrity of the process because regulations have the force of law. And secondly, the public interest is not being well served. And that's just in general. When people are doing it to make a lot of money at the expense of others, it's even worse. I had gotten an email from the attorney for the head of the National Black Chamber of Commerce. And he had, and we'll have this for anybody who didn't get the packet, if you provide your email, this will be in the email. But he went into great detail about the effect it has from his perspective of hurting people who really are hurting anyway and deserve better than this. And so, if you walk through the rest of the process, what happened at the Department of Education, they put together a committee that had 32 people that was going to be the committee that helped work on the regulation while it was in the process. Of the 32 people, only two, in any way, shape, or form, represented the proprietary schools, the trade, vocational, and career schools. So it was kind of one-sided. The key people involved were all individuals who had been working on this for some time, had close ties to the lobbyists, close ties to the people they put on the committee. In any way, shape, or by any yardstick, this was a stacked deck to end all stacked decks. And when they started getting embarrassing questions about it in the form of Freedom of Information Act requests, they somehow couldn't find them, they were delaying it, they were turning them down, they were doing everything until a federal judge made them release them. And they're still disputing a number of those. So that's the quick background on the process. What can be done? What's happening right now is the Inspector General of the Department of Education, after a letter signed by, I believe, 100 members of Congress, went over to the White House about this, right, decided he's going to investigate it. We have that. The second thing that needs to be done, and this is one of the things we've called for and a number of others have called for, and again, the statement by the representative of the National Black Chamber of Commerce is, congressional investigations center on whether the informal rulemaking that led to the gainful employment reg should became so biased with key individuals prejudging the merits and therefore should be declared illegal under the U.S. Administrative Procedure Act. That's it in a nutshell. And if this wasn't a case of bias regulation, I don't know what does. I mean, it seems to have, if you put together a checklist of what would make the process really unethical, you'd be hard-pressed to, you know, even if it were an exercise in creative writing, come up with a process more flawed and more damaging to the principles of transparency and accountability than this thing. The damage has already been done insofar as we assume the short sellers, who are not street people, stood to make lots of money because of the crash of the value of the stock. That's water over the dam, although another group and our group have filed letters with the Securities and Exchange Commission because you can't just do anything to short a stock.